flow. I wanna run over. I wanna run over. Fill me up till I overflow. I wanna run over. I've gotta run over. Fill me up till I overflow. I wanna run over. I wanna run over. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up. Till we all overflow.
Father God, we pray that you bless our service. Allow us to feel your presence and hear your voice. We pray that you would be glorified in our service. Allow your glory to rest upon Resurrection Baptist Church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our scripture for today is 1 Chronicles 29, verses 10 through 11, and it reads, David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly. Praise be to you, Lord, the God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. May our Father bless the reading and the hearing of his word.
Hello, boys and girls. Welcome to RBC's Kids Connection Moment. Today we will talk about the promises of God.
Promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. All the blessings of his love divine. Every promise in the book is mine.
Do you know what a promise is? A promise is something someone said they will do or not do for you. Has anyone ever broken a promise to you? How did you feel? Did you feel sad? Did you feel angry? Did you feel disappointed? Or did you feel like you couldn't trust that person anymore? Sometimes people are tricky and sneaky. For example, they can write it in invisible ink. And before you know it, it disappears. Or they could write it on a tablet, and while you're not looking, make it go away. So where's your proof now? God wrote down every promise that he said he would do. And where can we find this? We can find it in the Bible, God's holy word. Did you know that God made over 7,400 promises to us? Yep, that's a lot of promises. And he is faithful to fulfill each and every one of them. How do we know? It is written in the Bible. He promises things like, I will be with you always so that you'll never be alone. He promises that he will help you in times of trouble. He promised to give you peace when you're upset, and he promised to give you rest when you're tired. He also promised to never destroy the earth by water again, and the sign of that promise is the rainbow. Did you know that the fifth commandment was the first commandment with promise? It says in Exodus 20, honor your father and your mother, that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. So if you respect your parents, you might live a long life. So how do we know that God's promises won't fade away or disappear like the invisible ink or on the tablet? Because it is written in the book of Matthew, God said, heaven and earth may disappear, but I promise you not even a period or a comma will ever disappear from the law. Everything written in it must happen. So there you have it. God always keeps his promises, and you can trust him because he is our promise keeper. Thank you for tuning in to RBC's Kids Connection Moment, where kids learn to love and serve God by connecting to his word.
Good morning, Resurrection Baptist Church family, friends, and guests. My name is Jacqueline Dillon, and I'm a member of the Usher Ministry here at RBC. On behalf of our dynamic pastor, Reverend Dr. Marcus Jerkins, I'm excited to welcome you to our virtual Sunday morning service. If you're visiting with us today, thank you for joining us, and we would love to know who you are. So please send an usher in the Zoom chat your name, what city you are in, and the best way to get in contact with you. Please also let us know if you have any prayer requests. As always, we love to hear from our beloved congregation, so if you are joining us via Zoom on your computer or mobile device, please feel free to send a hello and a hallelujah in the chat. As a matter of housekeeping, please remember to keep your microphones muted throughout the service. However, feel free to keep your videos open and running. At the end of the service, we will have a time where everyone can be unmuted and you can say hello and to greet each other. Thank you again for joining us this morning, and let's have church.
Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. In Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30, Jesus spoke these words, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Gracious God, our Father, we just thank you for these words, that we know that we can find a comfort and rest when we turn our heart over to you. You also guided us in the words of your scriptures by telling us to cast our cares before you because you care for us. So this morning, Lord God, we are placing all of our burdens at your feet. Lord God, we must trust you because we know you are the only wise God, creator of heaven and earth, sustainer of our lives, creator of all good and wonderful things that we know in this life that we experience. But Lord God, as we have faced so many challenges over the last several months, we know, Lord God, our hearts and minds are sometimes growing weary. Oh, Lord God, I know there's someone sitting in their living room right now this morning who has thought about how difficult these last few months have been. Someone has even thought about how difficult the last few days have been. Oh, Lord God, we know that our brothers and sisters are struggling to keep food on their tables and to keep a roof over their heads and keep the lights on, to keep their home together so that they can make it through this future and the challenges that we find of these days. But Lord God, we know that we can, by casting our cares on you, you will and always will care for us. But Lord God, we must first confess that we haven't done everything according to your will. We have all sinned and come short of your glory, but we're thankful that you're a faithful and a just God, and you said you will not leave us nor forsake us, but you will give us an opportunity to continue to come to a right relationship with you because you will cast our sins into the sea of forgetfulness. So Lord God, this morning we lift up the difficulties that we face, the pandemic that is going on around the world. But in this nation, Lord God, we pray that you will help eliminate the confusion and eliminate the violence and eliminate the hatred and eliminate the evil that fills our streets. And we pray for this nation that we live in. We pray for the unity in our nation that allows us to say that one nation under God, that we should always be indivisible because there should be liberty and justice for all. So this morning, Lord God, we have confessed our sins and we know that you are faithful and a just God. But we ask, Lord God, that you will also consider blessing those that have illnesses this morning, even those that are going in for medical procedures and who have already had medical procedures and that are in a time of need for healing. Bless them in a mighty way. We ask that you would bless those who are providing care, the frontline workers in the hospitals and the nursing homes. And we ask that you would bless those that are working in the stores and in the markets places around this nation because and around the world as well, because they are also frontline individuals that are providing for us and giving us an opportunity to live a wonderful and joyous life and an abundant life that you have promised us. But now, Lord God, we know that we struggle. We struggle in our mind, we struggle in our spirit, trying to find out the answers that you would have for us. But Lord, we know that in the still, quiet time, that still, small voice, by your Holy Spirit, you will speak to us and give us the answers that we need. Because I'm encouraged this morning to know that I can keep my eyes on you, dear Lord, and that with you at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Lord, you will keep us in your righteous right hand. You will guide us and keep us and protect us by putting a hedge of protection around us. You will keep your spirit guiding us and guiding us through all these difficult times that we might know that we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus, who strengthens us. So Lord God, let us press on. Let us press on to the mark for the upward call that is in Christ Jesus. Let us cast aside all the sin and the weight that is so easily besetting us and not be worried about what happened yesterday, but only trust in Lord God that what you're going to provide for us in the next 5 minutes, in the next hour, in the next day, throughout the next 5 days, Lord, you are a God that will not leave us nor forsake us. That promise is in our heart and will not leave us. So we thank you now, Lord, for what you're about to do, and we thank you for what you've already done. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Yes, you are.
Oh,
Wherever you are, before we get into this message, won't you just lift your hands to heaven and say, Lord, you are worthy to be praised. Come on, everybody, just lift your hands wherever you are and just tell God how much you are grateful that God woke you up this morning. God started you on your way. God has been good to everybody here. Listen, if you know the Lord has been good to you, if you know the Lord has been good to you, even in your house, you ought to open your mouth and tell the Lord, thank you. You ought to open your mouth and say, God, I praise you. From the rising of the sun until the going down of the same, the name of the Lord is worthy. I wish I had a witness. The name of the Lord is worthy to be praised. Let me say, we have been having a powerful worship service as we do every week, but we thank God specifically this morning for the opportunity to feature our young people. I want to say thank God for Brother Young, and let me also say thank God to my little boy, Nathaniel, for the opportunity to do this. And listen, we want to include all of our children. So next for Sunday, we're going to be reaching out, and we want you to let your children be part of this. We need our children to read, to pray, and to be part of our worship service, because God enriches us when we allow our children to help us in worship. And because God is not only our God, but he's their God too. And so we want our children to participate, and we want our children to help us lead. This is how they develop. Even in this pandemic environment, saints, even in this virtual environment, we can still give our children opportunities to lead and to grow. And so we want to thank God for this opportunity to do that. And listen, so as we move forward, thank God for all of you. I have a word for you today, and I want you to go with me in your Bibles, the book of Matthew chapter number 6. Book of Matthew chapter number 6. Thank God for all those who are joining with us, for all our visitors. Thank God for all of you who are joining with us. We saw we have people from London who are here today. Thank you so much, Brother McCormick, for joining with us. We thank God for all of our visitors, and we praise God for what he's doing in our midst today. If you would turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 6. Before I go read the scripture, allow me to pray. Father, I thank you for the word of God. I thank you, God, for what you've shown us in your scripture. We pray, oh God, that you would speak to us now. Fill me now with the Holy Ghost so that I may speak your words with boldness. Do not allow me to speak an enticing word of human wisdom, but by demonstration of your spirit and your power, make your presence felt, known, and realized wherever we are. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Book of Matthew chapter number 6 from the 9th verse reads as follows. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as it is in heaven, so on earth. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. This morning, as the Holy Ghost instructed resurrection, I just want to talk for a few moments from the subject, Praying Effectively, Part 2. Praying Effectively, Part 2. I want apple juice. I want apple juice. If you come to the Jerkins household at almost any hour of the day, you will hear the phrase, I want apple juice. This phrase, brothers and sisters, comes from my beloved little boss, the four-year-old Joanna Jerkins. If you come to the Jerkins household, you will hear this phrase. You will hear, I want apple juice. And not only will you hear that, brothers and sisters, but if you get up at a certain point in the day, you will hear this same little lady tell her parents, I want chocolate. This might be at 9 o'clock in the morning, saints. 9 o'clock in the morning during breakfast time. I want chocolate. And brothers and sisters, this phrase has been prickly, particularly to her mother and me and her grandmother, because we've been trying to train her that that is not how you speak to those in authority. You don't come saying, I want apple juice. Not only is the manner in which she is speaking improper, but also when she asks for chocolate during breakfast time, the content is wrong. See, both the way she does it and what she's asking for are wrong. And brothers and sisters, we say these things are wrong because it's discourteous and rude. We say, no, baby, when you speak to us, you have to talk to us under the terms in which we conduct business in this house. And when we speak in this house, we speak respectfully. We speak in a way that's both courteous and kind. And so when you come and you want apple juice, you say, may I please have some apple juice, mommy, daddy, mimi. And we say, you don't ask for chocolate during breakfast time. That's not the time for that. Both the manner in which she asks for it and the content, brothers and sisters, must align with those who are in authority in this house, because that's how this house is run. That's how this particular part of the world conducts its business. And the same That thing that I can say about this house, brothers and sisters, is the same thing I can say about the kingdom of God. The same thing I can say about this house is the same thing I can say about the kingdom of God. Last week, I had a chance to talk to you about the when and the manner of prayer. That when we come to God with recognition that God doesn't want us to say a whole bunch of words. God is not interested in our coming to him thinking that God is ignorant, that God wants us to realize that he knows what we need before we ask. But brothers and sisters, we also need to know what we need to be asking for and the things we should be talking to God about using the very language that God says we should be using when we talk to him. And so today we want to talk to you from this particular point of preachment to suggest that our content has to be right. If we want our prayers to be effective, then we have to pray in a manner in which and with the content with which the Lord Jesus has given us to pray. Jesus says to us, when we pray, we are to pray, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Jesus says that our content must be right in order for God to hear our prayers. And brothers and sisters, this text is tailored to teach us that we as God's people must pray to God in a way that God wants to hear it. God wants to hear certain things when we pray. And when God hears those certain things when we pray, I believe, brothers and sisters, within my heart of hearts, God will hear and answer our prayers. There are a couple of things, brothers and sisters, that I want to share with us today that I believe will be helpful whenever you kneel down to pray, whenever you go to your closet to pray, whenever you go out in public to pray, that you offer these things to God, and I believe God will show up and God will show out on your behalf. Are you interested in some things that I want to offer to you, brothers and sisters? I hope you are, because I came to tell you something. Here it is. First is this. When we pray, if we're praying effectively, we must, brothers and sisters, give attention to the fact that God has all sovereignty. We must give attention to the fact that God is above all and is sovereign. Here it is. I'm preaching already. You may not even know it. Here it is. Jesus says, he says, when you pray, say, "Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name." He says, say, "Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Don't read the Bible too fast. That's how you miss something. Jesus is saying to us, when you pray, you must first acknowledge that you're speaking to the communal Father, the Father who is our Father. Here he uses the possessive third person plural. Jesus is saying he's our Father. All of us can claim him as our Father, which takes a little bit of humility, because I can't say he's my Father and not yours. I wish I had a witness. And Jesus is saying, when you pray, say, "Our Father, where is he who is in heaven? Your name is holy. Hallowed be your name." That's old English. In other words, saying that the name of the Lord is holy. And so in saying this, brothers and sisters, Jesus helps us to recognize that in prayer, we must recognize the sovereignty of God by recognizing his identity as our Father who is holy. Now here we have seemingly two opposing elements. The fact that God is both our Father and that God is holy. Here we have an element of God being our Father, which speaks to God's immanence, the fact that he's close to us. And then we have the fact that God is holy, which speaks to his transcendence, which means he's far beyond us. And in the midst of that, brothers and sisters, what Jesus is telling us to do is pay attention to the fact that God is worthy of our worship as Father and as the Holy One. And then he says this, not only must we pay attention to his identity, but when we look at his sovereignty, we also see something else. We also have to recognize his priorities. His priorities. Here's what he says. He says, when you talk to your Father, you recognize his identity, look at his priorities. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Here's what he's saying. He said, when you talk to God, you and I must recognize that on God's list of priorities, first of all, is nothing of human origin. You hear what I just said? When we pray to God, we pray to God recognizing that the thing that is on the top of his list is nothing of human origin. We pray not for our kingdom to come. We pray not for our will to be done, but for God's kingdom to come and for God's will to be done. Because here it is. Let me just say this to you, saints. This is, if you don't remember anything else that I tell you during this sermon, I want you to remember this. You get blessed when God gets what he wants. You and I get blessed when God has his way. Just in case, brothers and sisters, you didn't understand that, let me just tell you like this. There was a man named Luis Carlos. Luis Carlos was a Portuguese man, a man of great wealth, had a considerable fortune. And on his, during his death, during his, the time of his death, he had written a will. And in his will, he spoke to the notary right before the notary was to make his signature and told the notary, I want you to pull out the phone book. I want you to pull out the phone book. And when you pull out the phone book, what I want you to do is just pick random names. Random names. And the notary pulled out the phone book and started picking out names all over the phone book. When he started picking out names, so why am I picking out these names? The man said, because when I die, in my will, I'm making a bequest so that everyone whose name you pick out, when at the time of my death, my will be executed, and I want you to give my wealth to all these different names. Lord have mercy. So when Luis Carlos died, he gave his fortune over to 70 random people. And brothers and sisters, when his will was carried out, because of the great wealth that he had and the graciousness that was in him, other people got blessed. Just come talk to me for a second. Because if that happened for a man who died, how much more will that happen for a living father who loves his children? When the will of God is carried out because he is alive and well, the Bible teaches us that we will be rewarded. Because the Bible says every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither a shadow of turning. What he's saying is that every child of God can be confident in the fact that when you ask for God to have his way, when you say, Lord, your will be done, it may hurt sometimes, it may be rough sometimes, but in the end, brothers and sisters, he's able to make something good come out of it. I wish I had some help around here who could say that when God had his way, things in my life got better. In fact, every place where there's chaos is a place where God's kingdom is not doing what it's supposed to do in my life because I've not allowed it. But God says things will get better when you let me have my way. Brothers and sisters, not only But should we pay attention to the fact that he is in control, that he is sovereign, that we want him to have his way? But we also have to pray. When we pray, not only pay attention to his sovereignty, but we also, brothers and sisters, must pay attention to asking him and recognizing that from him all sustenance comes. We must ask him for sustenance. Here's what Jesus says. He says, not only should we pray for the kingdom, he says, but also he said, give us this day our daily bread. He says, give us our daily bread. Here Jesus is invoking the language of the Exodus. We're going through that in Bible study. If you haven't been coming to Bible study, you're missing a treat, because we've been talking about the fact that God has been giving manna from heaven. God has provided bread in the wilderness. And Jesus was saying that when you are in the wilderness, you need somebody to make sure you can eat every day. And brothers and sisters, we have been reminded of that truth in this time like no other in our lives. During this pandemic, we even have members in our church who have lost their jobs. And we pray for you, and we stand with you, and we stand ready to do whatever we can to help you in your time of need. But brothers and sisters, never take the fact that you eat every day for granted. I wish I had a witness in here. Never take the fact that you have something to eat for granted. There are 821 million people around the world who suffer from hunger. Brothers and sisters, at least as far as 2018 was concerned, the people who were suffering from hunger, 821 million. And brothers and sisters, who's to say you and I may not be part of that number one day? Because of what we have now, we can't expect we're going to have that tomorrow. And that's why we must pray and ask God to take care of us every day. You don't need God just to make sure you eat today. You need to make sure God helps you eat tomorrow. And you don't need God just to help you make sure that you eat tomorrow. You need God to help you make sure that you can eat the next day and the next day. I wish I had a witness. What the Lord is saying is that we have to rely on the Lord to make sure that we survive. That's why the songwriter says, he's all over me and he's keeping me alive. It's because of the grace of God, because of the mercy of God, that we're able to stand. So our sustenance comes from him and no other place. Brothers and sisters, I press on, but I stop here to tell you that you and I must always recognize that we can never survive without him. We can never live without him. We can never move without him. In fact, that's why Paul said, in him we live and move and have our being. Brothers and sisters, when we recognize our sustenance comes from him, when we pray, we must also pray one more thing. And this brings it all together. And I'm done. The last thing is this. When we pray effectively, not only are we praying for sustenance, but we're also praying for salvation. Must give attention to salvation. Now here's how he says it. He says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not to temptation to the temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Here's what Jesus says. He says to us that when we pray, we ought to ask God to forgive us as we forgive others. Because salvation involves not only the release of our debts with God, but the release of debts for one another. So we must be willing to let people go for the wrongs they've done. And Jesus emphasizes this so much that he repeats it after he finishes this prayer, that you and I can't expect God to forgive us if we're unwilling to act like God in forgiving others. Let me say that one more time. You and I can't expect God to forgive us if we're unwilling to act like the God who forgave us in forgiving one another. Did y'all catch that? If you want God to forgive you, act like him and forgive somebody else. I'm moving on. So not only is forgiveness necessary, but we're also praying that God keep us from temptation. Keep us from the time of temptation, which comes to everybody. But this is the statement, I believe, that ties it all together. Because Jesus says, don't allow us to enter temptation. He says, but deliver us. Here it is. Deliver us from the evil one. You hear that? Deliver us. Now, your Bible, my Bible, King James says evil. But in the Greek here, we have what is called a nominal adjective. In other words, the adjective is not just conceptual or it's not abstract. The adjective here is meant to be understood as a person. You hear what I just said? He's not just saying evil in the abstract. He's talking about the devil. When he says, deliver us from the evil one, because brothers and sisters, everybody in this church must recognize that all of us are fighting the devil. I wish I had a witness. Every last one of us is fighting the devil. We all have a common enemy who has made it his job to try to destroy each and every last one of us. The devil wants to kill us. The devil wants to destroy us. The devil wants to remove us from the hands of God. But here's what Jesus says. He says, we must appeal to God because of the fact that we need God to deliver us from Satan. And people in the ancient world understood this. Jesus understood this and his followers understood it because they were dealing with the devil with his foot on their neck. And they looked at the Romans. Jesus was saying, he did not say to them that we should pray that the Romans have gastrointestinal difficulties. He did not say that we should pray that the Pharisees and Sadducees have their teeth rot and fall out of their mouths. He says, Lord, we ask you to deliver us from the power of Satan. Because Satan, brothers and sisters, has set up systems from then until now that has caused human corruption throughout every generation. And everywhere you look, brothers and sisters, you can see how Satan has put his ugly hands on stuff all around us. Everywhere you look, if you look, brothers and sisters, at even currently the voting process, oh, Lord have mercy, I got to talk about it, saints, because even now, brothers and sisters, we have to pray because our people, black folks, have seen this. We're used to folks telling us to count the amount of bubbles on a bar of soap in order to vote. But now we're seeing that people are trying to shut down the voting process and make it more difficult for everybody to vote in the middle of the pandemic. But the devil is a liar. We are not going to be silent. We are going to speak not only what the Lord has shown us in his word, but we are going to get on our knees and we are going to trust God because we're going to march with our feet and our knees. We're going to believe and know that once we do that, we're going to get our balance and we are going to vote because the Lord has called us for such a time as this. Let me move on before I start going somewhere. And so, brothers and sisters, the enemy works in various areas of our society. You can see him with regard to racism, when people are corrupted to believe that because of their physical differences, that one person is better than the other. You can see it, brothers and sisters, in sexism. Well, because of gender differences, one gender is better than the other. You can see it, brothers and sisters, in terms of classism, where people are consumed with their amount of wealth and they think because of the amount of wealth I have, I'm better than somebody else. You can see it, brothers and sisters, in terms of ageism, because we start thinking that the elderly, the seasoned saints, are worthless and are not as important as us. And so we can throw them to the side and say that we don't mind, as one leader said in Texas, we don't mind if the aged die from the coronavirus for the sake of our economy. Brothers and sisters, but I've come by to tell you that the kingdom of God demands that we resist such notions, and that we lift up those who are poor. We lift up those who are downtrodden. We lift up those who have been set aside, because God has called us to do these things. Blessed are the poor in spirit, Jesus said. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who have been tossed aside, because God cares about them. And I've done, brothers and sisters, but I've come to tell you that we must pray that the Lord deliver us from the evil one. We don't take sides with the evil one. We don't join the cause of the evil one. But I heard James say it like this: submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Is there anybody who can say that I'm going to stand my ground and pray to my Father and believe that we will overcome the power of Satan? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, when I look at this text, I hear the challenge of Jesus for us to pray effectively, recognizing that we can only get our salvation from him, recognizing that only from him will come our deliverance. And brothers and sisters, we cannot be like we have been. We have been willing to be comfortable with dysfunction, and we have been willing to say to evil, we'll just make ourselves cozy during this time. Deliver us from evil. We can't do that. And we also can't turn to fiction in this time. We can't turn to fables. That's what people have done. You know it. You know it. And I know it, because I've lived on it most of my life. During the year 1938, Jerry Siegel and Joe Sister developed a hero. A hero, brothers and sisters, who would fight maniacal villains who were bent on world domination. These villains would try to construct schemes, plots that would overcome the world to make them lords of the globe. Joel and Jerry Siegel and Joe Sister developed this hero in such a way, in their imaginations, featured in the first action comic of 1938. And in this action comic, we saw the entrance of a figure called Superman. You know who I'm talking about. Superman. Superman, brothers and sisters, who was impervious to bullets, was able to leap over tall buildings, was able to defy gravity and fly. He was faster than a speeding bullet. And brothers and sisters, when we look at evil in our imaginations, the human idea is to go to fiction, to create heroes who will help us in our minds deal with evil. But regardless of how strong Superman can punch, regardless of how fast Superman can run, he can't knock out Satan, and he sure can't outrun him. Brothers and sisters, we don't have to have fiction. We don't have to go away in our minds to imagine a world in which evil does not exist and can be overcome by comic book characters. We have in the Word of God everything we need to overcome the power of the wicked one. Because, brothers and sisters, can I tell you something? Jesus didn't say, deliver us from the evil one, save us from the power of Satan, because he has empty words. He meant every word, despite all that happened to him. I'm done, but my soul just got happy, because I started thinking about the fact that Jesus already had a plan on how the power of Satan would be broken. Because the Bible says that one day Judas betrayed him. One day Peter denied him. One day, the Sanhedrin Council condemned him. And one day, Pilate crucified him. And one day, the soldiers and the people mocked him. And one day, that Roman cross killed him. But can I tell you, brothers and sisters, that my joy is in the fact that he died. But I get extra happy when I start thinking about the fact that even though Judas betrayed him, even though Peter denied him, even though the Sanhedrin Council condemned him, even though Pilate crucified him, even though the people and the soldiers mocked him, even though the cross killed him, that God raised him, because on the third day, he got up with all power in his hands. Is there anybody who can say that you are going to pray and know that God will deliver you from evil? Not just because these are empty words, because they're not empty words. Not a single word will fall to the ground. He got up and he has power in his hands. Resurrection Baptist Church, may the Lord God bless you real good. But on my way to my seat, I came by to tell you that he got up, and because he got up, Satan can't stop you. Your friends can't resist you. Your enemies can't overcome you. Because of what he has done, no sickness has the final say. Because he got up, we can declare that all power is in his hands. Because at the cross where I first saw the light, there the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Is there anybody in this church who can say I'm happy? Not because all my bills are paid, not because everything in my life is right, not because I feel good all the time, but because Jesus lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because he lives, I know my life has a future. All because he lives. Can you say yes? Say yes. Say yes. Because he lives, we know our salvation is secure. Brothers and sisters, wherever you are, whatever is going on in your life, when you pray, and you must pray, make sure to give attention to his sovereignty. Make sure to ask him for sustenance, and make sure to give attention to your need for salvation. Now, as I close the sermon, won't you pray with me the Lord's Prayer, wherever you are. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Listen, the door of the church is open. The door of the church is open wherever you are, whatever you're going through. You may not know Jesus, but you know one thing. You know you're in trouble. And can I tell you something? That if you want somebody who will be with you, who will not abandon you, who will take care of you in your time of trouble, Jesus is just who you need. So we want to offer Christ to you. If you confess him as your Lord and Savior, if you pray to him, he will answer. We want to offer Christ to you. If you want to be saved, please send a note to either Reverend McPayton. You can send a note to Reverend Maxwell. You can send a note to Reverend Carter, Elder Carter. You can send a note to Dr. Poole, Reverend Poole. And so we're all available to you to pray with you. And we're here to offer salvation to you. Christ died for your sins, and to get you out of what you're in, to deliver you to where he wants you to be. The door of the church has been opened to you. And also, brothers and sisters, as we pray, when we pray that somebody will respond, if they don't respond today, they will respond, because the Lord's word will not come back to him void. And so, brothers and sisters, we pray this prayer. We also ask you to make sure to take heed to what God is saying to us as a church. There will be things that we put in the update that you'll see, things that we need to make sure that we put our hands around as a church, things that we're going to be looking towards doing, not only in 2020, but in 2021. So we need you to keep giving strongly, give generously. Everybody, wherever you are, say generously. Give not only generously, give sacrificially. Give sacrificially. That means that if you can go above and beyond your tithes and offerings, you should. If you haven't, we want you, brothers and sisters, to give generously and sacrificially. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. That means that God will give more to those who are willing to give back to him. It's not always in money. It's not always in money, but it will be in some way, somehow, God will show you that he has benefits for those who give to him. And so we ask you, brothers and sisters, to give. You can give through Givelify on our website, resurrectionbaptist.com. resurrectionbaptist.com, through Givelify. You can give through PayPal. You can give an online payment from your bank account. We can work with you on that. Or you can send your check or whatever form of payment you want to send to 900 Edna Road, Silver Spring, Maryland, 20905. 900 Edna Road, Silver Spring, Maryland, 20905. And listen, we thank you for your gifts. We have capital improvements to make. We have some things we need to make also in our building in order for our church to be more youth-friendly. And other things we want to do, God is going to use this church to do great and mighty things. But all that we need is in your pockets. And so we need you to give generously in order for us to make it to the things that God wants us to do. So thank you so much. We praise God for you. The Jerkins family loves you. I thank God for our young people, Brother Young and Brother Jerkins, for praying and offering scripture for us. We thank God for Sister Maxwell and that kids moment, the kids connection moment. We thank God for more and more things that our church is doing, for our deacons, our trustees for their labor, deacons and trustees for all the labor and all of our ministries who are continuing to work. I'm going to try my best to be at the health and wellness session tomorrow. If you can be at that session so we can exercise together, we're going to get fit together. We're going to win souls together. We're going to go out here and get people to know who Jesus is together. We're going to pass out food. We're going to do everything we can so that others may see the kingdom of God come down on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you so much, Resurrection. May God bless you and keep you. Let's pray together. God and Father, my Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for the word that you shared with us. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you help us to put an emphasis on prayer, the necessity to talk with you, the necessity to surrender ourselves to your word. And so we pray, oh God, that you help us, Father, to recognize that you are holy, that you are above all, and that you are sovereign, you are in control. And because of that, Father, we pray that you help us to also ask for what we need. When we need sustenance, when we need healing, when we need deliverance, we ask you for that. And we also ask you to help us to pray for our salvation, to know that there's no one else who can stop the enemy but you. But we thank you that he has been stopped, and that more and more you will continue to deliver us from the power of the wicked one. We praise you. We give you glory for it now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. May the grace of the Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Ghost rest, rule, and abide with you now, henceforth, and forevermore. And everybody said amen. Have a wonderful week.
Amen.
Resurrection, we love you. God bless
amen.
You. Look forward to seeing you soon.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.